Hello, everyone. Welcome back to My Sheep Hears My Voice Ministries. Today, I wanted to talk about resisting the tempter and ignoring the attractions of the devil. Today, in Genesis 2, 7, and 8, it talks about Adam and Eve. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he formed. So in Genesis 2, 7, and 8, we know that God is the creator of man. And we also know that God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and he put the man whom he created in the garden. Let's go on to see what happened. In Genesis 2, 16, and 17, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. Enjoy all the trees in the garden, Adam. Enjoy all the grapes, the apples, the oranges, whatever the fruit trees were. Enjoy these. Enjoy them. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt now eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. What is the Lord saying? Now, I didn't give you instructions. You can enjoy all these trees in this garden, but there's one tree of knowledge of good and evil. The day you eat it, you will die. Genesis 2:18, and the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helpmeet for him. God gave Adam a beautiful wife by the name of Eve. Someone that will help him out and have his back. First, God created Adam, and then he created Eve. In Genesis 2:15, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. So God knew Adam needed help. That's why he said it's not good that man should be alone. So he put a woman of God in Adam's life. Adam didn't go out searching around looking for nobody. God put that woman there in his life. Now we're going to go on to Genesis chapter 3. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Now he done set up here and twist God's word completely around. He's talking to Eve. Did God say you can't eat of every tree in the garden? This is how the devil gets started. This is how evil gets started. Now here's Eve talking, Genesis 3, 2 and 3. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. Now, something stood out to me that in this scripture right here. That's why it's very important to read the word of God for yourself and not listen to what other people have to say. Because God didn't say, if you touch it. He didn't say anything about touching it. He said, the day that you eat thereof, you will surely die. This is what God told Adam. He didn't say nothing about touching it. So that's why it's very important for you to open up your Bible and read the word of God for yourself and read it from word to word. Because it can be one little word in there that you needed to hear that help you through whatever situation, that help you feel better or lead or guide you the answer that you was looking for. So get in that word for yourself and read it for yourself and know what the word of God is saying to you. God said, if you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, in that day you will surely die. He didn't say nothing about touching it. Now here is Eve. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. So the words was twisted right here. In Genesis 3 and 4, here comes Satan coming back. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. Now he lied. He lied. He's a liar. Because if you go back into Genesis 2, 16 and 17, God said, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. So God did say the day you eat of it, that day you will die. You will spiritually die. But Satan told Eve right here, and the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. Now that's a lie. Because he wanted Eve to disobey God. That's what it was. Because he knew that it was consequences for disobeying God. Because look at the situation that he's in right now. In Genesis 3 and 6, and when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired, to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. Now we have two people that have disobeyed God. Instead of them getting on one accord and doing what thus says the Lord, they went in their own way. 1 Peter 5 and 8 says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. And that's exactly what he was doing to Adam and Eve. He went in that garden and he went on an evil mission. He knew when he went in there, he went to tear some stuff up. That's what the enemy come to do. He come to kill, he come to steal, and he come to destroy. This is a warning to never disobey God. Because when you disobey God, Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death. When you serve sin, payment is death. How do we keep from being deceived by Satan? James 4 and 7 says, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. This is the only way that we can resist the devil when he dangle things and tempt us to do things that God has told us specifically not to do. God give us instructions right now today not to do certain things. And we run and we do it anyway. And then when we have to suffer the consequences for it, we sitting around crying trying to figure out, why is this happening to me? Instead of sitting down and taking inventory and thinking, well, maybe I'm doing something that's wrong and I need to see what I did so I can correct that and don't do that again. If Satan can get the parents to disobey God and not get on one accord, then he can have his way with our children. If Satan can get parents to be arguing and fighting and blaming each other for their problems, drinking, partying, smoking, not going to church, not reading a word, not surrendering to God's will, in the midst of them being in darkness, the devil is having his way with our children. Our children is out here drinking, they smoking, they fornicating, they lying, they stealing, they partying, they drinking, they hooked on Xbox games, cell phones, social media. He having his way with our children. And you know why? Because we as parents are not lining up with God's word. And that's why Satan is tearing our children down right now today. If he can tempt us to do the things that God told us not to do and keep us in bondage, then our children don't have a chance. And then when your children see you doing these things, and then when you try to come back and correct them on something, they're not going to listen. Because they see what you're doing or what I'm doing, and then they're not going to listen. So this is what this lesson is about. Parents need to get on one accord with the Lord first. Do what thus says the Lord first. If God says not to do it, then don't do it. And then through your obedience to the Lord, now you can teach your children how to be obedient. Now you can raise your children up in a fear and admonition of the Lord. But if Satan can keep the parents at odds with each other, and there's a lot of that going on right now in the homes. Parents is not getting along. The mother and father is not getting along. The boyfriend and the girlfriend is not getting along. Fighting in the home going on. Cussing going on in the home. Partying and drinking going on in the home. Lying and stealing and going on in the homes. And the kids is sitting back watching everything, trying to figure out which way to go. And they don't know which way to go. They don't know who to go to, who to ask. Then when they go to school, they act out. They show that same behavior that they seeing at home. They go to school and display that out in their classrooms and around their friends and stuff like that. That's why kids go to school and fight. Because they see fighting going on at home. That's why kids go to school and pull weapons. Because they see the parents pulling weapons on each other and cutting each other and doing things like that. They see smoking going on at home. That's why kids sneak behind the school buildings and smoke. Because Satan knows that if he can start from the head and keep the head in distractions, and keep the head broke down, and keep the head strung out on drugs, and keep the head drunk and full of alcohol all the time, then he can tear our children apart. And that's what Satan is trying to do. Because we choose as parents not to line up with the Lord and get on one accord and run our households the way God has told us to run our homes. He has given the woman instructions, and he's also given the husband instructions how that home's supposed to be ran. But are we doing it? No, we're not. Because everybody is caught up into their own selves. Everybody want to do it the way they want to do it. And our children is suffering for it right now today. All our children want to do is drink. All our children want to do is smoke. Marijuana is so popular throughout our generation right now with our children. That's all they want to do is smoke. That's it. They'll do anything for it. Steal from their parents. Fight their parents. Cuss their parents out. Whatever it takes to get it, that's what they're doing right now today. And all that's doing is messing with our kids' brain. They can't remember how to do math. They barely know how to read. They don't even know how to spell, because that stuff tears up your memory. But we so busy doing what we want to do and not doing what God told us to do first that we can't even raise our children the right way. And I'll be the first to admit it. I was one of those parents that didn't want to do nothing but party when I was growing up. I threw parties just about every night. I wanted to drink. I wanted to have a good time. And yes, I did take my children to church, but I was the biggest hypocrite walking around because right after church, I was drinking beer and right back partying again. And it didn't profit me one thing. And I showed my kids how to go to church and be a hypocrite. I was in church jumping around, playing like I had the Holy Ghost, and I didn't have nothing but a six-pack waiting on me at home in the refrigerator. And now, right now, today, when I see my kids making those mistakes, it hurt because they saw me doing it. So now I have to pray and ask God. I need God's help with my children right now, just like a lot of more parents do in this world. I'm just one person that don't mind sharing my testimony. It hurts when you see your children doing drugs and drinking and partying, and you know that that's the wrong road after you done gotten saved and your kids are still out there lost in darkness. It hurts. And that comes because from being disobedient and not surrendering and getting right with God, not getting in that Bible and seeing what thus says the Lord. Too busy running in and out the liquor store trying to find the next party. Trying to find the next good time. And our children is suffering for it right now today. So if this message is for, whoever this message is for, it's for me too. It's time to be burning and shining lights in our home for our children. It really is time for parents to get on one accord and stop all this arguing and bickering and being caught up into themselves so bad until we can't even reach our children, because it's all about us and what we want. Our children need us. And sometimes when you tell your children something that's right, they don't want to hear it. But I always remember my pastor, and my pastor and first lady always say, they'll hate you now and love you later. Because you're teaching them something that's right, that's going to benefit them in the latter end. They need us. Stop trying to be friends with them and be parents. Because if you be friends with them, then you just lost your position as a parent. Because now they're going to view you as a friend instead of viewing you as a parent. And Satan don't have no good intentions towards us or towards our children. And it starts with us parents. We have to line up with the word of God. And then after we line up with the word of God, then we can start teaching our children what's right, whether they want to hear it or not. And then the children have to learn how to be obedient to the parent when they come and tell you something that's right. Stop blaming your parents for the mistakes that you made, because it gets to a point where you know right from wrong. I don't care what you saw your parents doing. If they come in to tell you something that's right, you need to open up your ears and listen to their advice. You need to listen to your parents when they're telling you to do something that's right. And you see a lot of children right now today, well, you used to do it. That's right, I used to do it. But God has brought me away from that now. So now I'm trying to help you and show you the way. But a lot of children don't want to accept that, because they want to use the excuse. Well, you used to do it, mama. You used to drink. You used to smoke. I want to find it out my own way. You did it. Let me learn. And then when you step back and let them learn, the first person they come running to when they find out that the road is hard, mama, I should have listened to you because you was right. You told me right. I was right. But now you got to suffer the consequences. You have to suffer the consequences because of the choices and decisions that you have made. You chose to disobey me. Just like Adam and Eve chose to disobey God, it was consequences behind that. You don't get to do what you want to do and then think you get away with it. When you be disobedient, there's consequences. So I thank God for you all tuning in to my lesson. I thank God that I was able to share my testimony. And the only thing that I'm saying is that parents, let's get it together for our children. Let's get it together because they need us. Because the Bible says it clearly. The Bible says it clearly in 1 Peter 5 and 8. Be sober. That means be sober. Physically, that means put those drugs down. Put that alcohol down. That's what they're saying physically. But spiritually, it's saying be calm, be collected, use good sense, good judgment, use wisdom, be level-headed in the time of stress. Because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, and I know we don't watch the Animal Channel, animals can be real ferocious. I sat and watched them how they hunt. They very skilled at hunting. They'll sit and see they prey, and they'll hide down in them weeds and stuff, and they be crawling down through them weeds, and they have their eyes on their prey the whole time. And when they get close enough, they go in for the kill. And I noticed that they go in for the throat because they try to suffocate. They suffocate their prey. He walk about seeking whom, whoever he can devour. Satan don't have no respect to person. He'll take a baby out if he can. He don't have no respect of person. He walk about seeking whom he may devour. Let's be careful, women of God, women all across the world, the way we dress our children and babies. Sometimes we put them little tank tops on them with them little tight little pants and stuff like that. That's not cute. It's not. It's not. It's really not cute to dress your babies like that. Let's cover our babies up and give our babies more respect than that and raise them up right. Because if you putting that type of stuff on those babies now and your little young girl toddlers now, they're going to want that same stuff on when they become teenagers. And then it's not going to be fun anymore. So we have to be careful what we're doing. We have to line up with God and seek the Lord and know how to raise our children right. And when we see our children with this stuff on, get in there and take it off. Go take that tank top off and that shirt and go cover yourself up. This is what God is expecting for us to do, parents. And children, God is expecting for you to be obedient. If your parent tell you to go take it off, get in there and take it off. This is what God is expecting for us to do. Because he walk about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He's coming to tear people's homes up. He coming to tear your children down. He coming to bring your kids where they can't even focus. These Xbox games is terrible. You can call them four or five times. They so addicted to the Xbox game, they won't even come eat dinner half of the time. Take a shower. Get up and brush it. The first thing they do when they wake up in the morning, Xbox. In the evening, Xbox. Noonday, Xbox. Midnight, Xbox. That's an addiction. That's not cute. Girl, he be on the Xbox all day. That's not cute. That is an addiction. Sitting there on the Xbox, no books, no math, nothing. No word of God. No get out there and rake the leaves. No get in there and clean up and take the trash out. None of that. Just Xbox all day long. And God ain't pleased with that. So that was my lesson today. My lesson today was ignoring the attractions of the devil. Because he tried to tear us apart with different attractions. Things that God told us not to do, he tried to make it look like it's fun and exciting. Yeah, let's throw this big party and get all of this alcohol and we gonna cut the music up loud and we just gonna have a good time. Any and everybody is invited. I know because I was one of those people. And it's not right. So let's get lined up with God, parents. And children, you get lined up with your parents. When they telling you something that's right, God expects for you to do it. Because he said, children, obey your parents and the Lord, for this is right. Honor your mother and father. And that was my lesson for today. I hope whoever it was for, that they received it. Because God said his word won't come back unto him void. And I will see you next time. God bless.